Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. This is my first video actually, and I have created this channel basically to help students at the time when the we all know that the contagious disease COVID-19 is troubling the entire world, and due to this lockdown in the country, I think our students are missing their studies. So I'll be happy if I can help students with this video in their studies. So without wasting time, let me start with the today's topic. Today we'll be learning about the bolted joints and connections. So before going to the bolted connections, let me tell you why we need connections. You all know that when a steel structure is made, it is an assemblage of different members like beams, columns, etc. will be connected, and then only a steel structure will be formed. Yes or no? So basically, why connections? These connections are to form the steel structure. Different members of steels are connected, and these connections are done so that the flow of forces and moments from one another is easily flowing. So, and also we have the basic goal of connection is that to produce a joint that is safe, economical and simple also. Okay, so what are balls? We know connection, we are connecting the members, right? The steel members. But how to connect? We will need some fasteners, and these are the balls. Balls are nothing but they are the fasteners which are used to connect or hold different metal plates. You will see here this figure. Here this portion is known as your shank area. This is the thread. These portions are called to be thread. From here the bolt head to the bottom portion is known as your, this is the length of the bolt, this is the bolt head. And this is the nominal diameter actually. That means if you are told that whenever you are told that a diameter, a bolt of 16 mm diameter or 20 mm diameter, that means nothing but this diameter. The diameter of this portion is said to be the bolt diameter. This can be hexagonal. Then this is the nut. Nut sizes are also mentioned to you here. Okay, now next, if we see, we'll see the types of balls. Okay, how many types of balls are there? So first is what? Unfinished balls. Next we have the high strength balls. So let us first see what are unfinished balls. Unfinished balls are nothing but they are also known as ordinary balls, sometimes black balls, sometimes C grade balls, sometimes common balls. And also, now the next point is what? Made from, these are made of mild steel. These are made of mild steel rods with a square or hexagonal head and nuts. Now next point is what? Used in light structures under static loads such as small truss, purlins, etc. That means this unfinished balls, these unfinished balls are, this can never be used in structures where you see where there are vibrations or dynamic loads. This can only be used in structures where static loads are present. Okay, vibrating loads, if you tell the vibrating loads, that means what? Suppose in a railway track. Okay, so a railway track, those are steel structures and these are to be connected. Those steel rail gauges which are to be connected, they undergo various vibrations due to train movement of the train. So these unfinished balls cannot be used in those members. Okay, so next is what? See, not recommended. These are not recommended for connections related to impact, fatigue or dynamic loads. And these are also least expensive balls since they are unfinished balls. Then next is what? Next is your high strength balls. Now what are your high strength balls? These are made from bars. These are made from bars of medium carbon steel. Then we have these high strength balls are non-slip connections or friction type connections. As I told you, they will have a friction type connection, means what? Vibrations will be there. They will transfer the load with by vibrating or by due to friction. They will, with the help of friction, they will transfer the loads. This high strength balls. Then comes your tensile. Next point is the tensile strength of these kind of balls are very much higher than the ordinary black balls. The number of balls required at a joint is considerably reduced. Obviously, it is reduced. Why? Because this is high strength balls, and the black balls were lesser strength than this ball. So obviously, the number of balls of those black balls would be less, more as compared to the high strength. They will provide higher strength at lower number of balls, right? So this is done. Next, we'll see what are bolted joint types. That means how many types of bolted joints are there. First is your lap joint. Now, what is lap joint? You know, this is the figure. You can check here. See, lap joints are what? Nothing but this is the, when two plates overlap each other, they are known as lap joint. This is lapped over each other. Okay, so these two are lapped and it is connected. These two are plates are connected with the help of a bolt line. The number balls are used to join or connect these two plates. Okay, now the types of lap joint is what? One is single bolted lap joint. See, what a single bolted lap joint. This is a normal lap joint. One is over the other. This plate is this above this, and you can see here, this is the plan. This portion of the bottom plate you cannot see, so I have used dotted lines. So but at, from the side view, if you see, this is the bolt line. That means nothing but this bolts, and it is a single bolt line. So single bolted lap joint. Next is your what? Double bolted lap joint. This is a single normal lap joint. This plate is lapped over this, but here two lines of row, that is that balls, that means two rows of balls are used. This one from side, if you see, so that is why they are known as the double bolted lap joint. Now next, if we see, next kind of joint is the butt joint. Butt joint, you see here in this figure, butt joints are nothing but these connections are called to be butt joints, where two plates, this plate and this plate, are to be connected with the cover plate. Okay, these two plates are connected with the help of this cover plate. This bottom margin or the line joining these two is not seen, so we have used these dotted lines. So these two portions of the plates are connected with this line of bolt. These two are connected with the help of this line, and ultimately the entire is connected, entire plates are connected. Now bolt butt joints are what? This is a first one is your single cover butt joint, single bolted joint. That means, see here, this normal butt joint, two plates are connected to each other, edge to edge, with their edges and sides, with the help of a cover plate. And here one single cover plate is used, so single cover butt joint. And since these two are representing a kind of lap joint, and here one bolt line is used to connect this two portion, and to connect this two portion, obviously if we connect only this portion, this connection will have a unfinished connection. Okay, which due to which it may fail, the connection may fail. So this side also a row of bolt is done. Okay, so here, see here, this is for connecting this two, there is a single bolt line. For this two, a single bolt line. Okay, so therefore single bolted, these are known as single bolted single cover butt joint. Next is your double bolted single cover butt joint. See here, double bolted, but this is also same single cover. These two plates are connected adjacent sides, with their adjacent sides and with the help of this cover. And here these two plates from this side, this portion is connected with the help of two rows of balls, and this side it is connected with the help of two rows of balls. That is why double bolted single cover butt joint. Okay, next is your single bolted double cover butt joint. Now you see here, this is a butt joint, that means this edge to edge plates are connected with the help of cover plates, and here in this case we have what, one cover plate is at the top and another cover plate is at the bottom. But bolts are how much? A single bolts are done, single bolted line, this one single bolted to connect these portion, a single line of bolt is used, and this to connect this connection, to connect these plates, single row of bolt is used. So single bolted double cover butt joint. Next is what? Double bolted double cover butt joint. You know this is double cover, as here similarly both at the top and bottom we have cover plates connecting these two plates, but here at this portion connecting at this portion, this connection is done with the help of double bolted. That means two rows of bolts are used to connect this portion, and to connect this portion, this side of the connection, two bolt rows are used, therefore double bolted double cover butt joint. Okay, now we have gone through joint. Now we'll see what are the types of failure that may occur in a bolted connection. First of all, we'll see the shear failure of a joint. The bolt may fail in shear. See here, you can see this is a connection, these two plates are lap jointed, tension is here. Now when there is tension on both the sides, what is happening here? There is shear on the bolt, and due to this shear there occurs a failure in the connection. So when the bolt fails due to shear, it is called as shear failure of the joint or plate. Next is your bearing failure of the joint. So what is bearing failure? Bearing failure, see here, this sometimes your bolt may fail in this way, like when tension is here on both sides, this is your bolt, but here at this portion so much tension is here that at this portion there is some kind of compressive force on the bolt, on this bolt. So what will happen then? This compression will break or crush this bolt. See, but the bolt is here on its own line, not unlike this, it is sheared. But here what happens? It was strong enough, but due to this tension, due to this plate's push, the bolt got crushed here. So this type of failure is called as bearing failure of the joint. Bearing failure is nothing but the crushing, you can see. Next is what? Tension failure of the joint. See, this is a bolt, it can fail in this way when tension is here on the bolt. This is a tension failure of the plate. See here, these two are the plates, tension is here on both the sides. Now what happens? Due to sometimes your bolt may fail in tension, like how this plates are pulled, then this bolt is in its position, but due to this tension it may try to come out in upper direction with a pull tension due to this plate. Okay, so this are known as your tension failure. Next is your most important, another important one is block failure. See, when you are connecting a gusset plate and a flange of an I-beam or any column flange or beam flange, anything, then what happens? These are the bolted connection. This may fail how? Your bolt may be on its own place, but this gusset plate which is connected, it may come out in this way. Okay, it may tear and come out as a block from here to here. It may tear from here to here to here. It may come out in this way. This is nothing but a block failure. This is known as block failure. Now, next is what? We'll know about the grades. What can be the grades of these balls? There must be some grades, right? So these are the grades 4.6. Your balls can be of 4.6 grade, 5.6, 6.5, etc. Now what is can be the ultimate tensile stress of these grades of bolt? Then also again, what can be the yield stress FYB of this grades of bolt? Okay, we don't know that, right? So suppose we take an example of these bolt grade of 4.6 grade of bolt. Suppose we take an example of 4.6 grade of bolt. Now what will be its FUB? Ultimate tensile stress will be 4 into 100 and your FYB will be 400 into 0.6. Why? Because we know in steel construction, generally balls of property class 4.6 are used. And in this property, what happens, you know, this number 4 is indicating what? This indicates the 1 by 100 of the nominal ultimate tensile strength in Newton per mm square. And the number 6 indicates the ratio of the yield stress to the ultimate stress. Yield stress to the ultimate stress expressed as percentage. Okay, so therefore, the ultimate tensile strength of the ball 4.6 is 400 and your FYB, the yield stress, is 0.6 times of the yield stress. Okay, this one comes to be 240 Newton per mm square. Now next is what? Yeah, ultimate tensile stress, FUB, and the yield stress. This is a table I had given an example right now for 4.6, and this is the table for all the 4.6, 5.6, 6.5, all those. What are the FUB, what is your FYB, I have given, okay, in this table. Now next is what? Yeah, these are the terms to know in your bolted connections. Whenever you are learning or doing any problems regarding the bolted connections, you have to know these terms. What is the first term, which important one is pitch distance. Pitch distance is what? This is the distance between two consecutive balls which are measured parallel to the direction of the force. Next important one is what? The gauge distance. This is the distance between two consecutive balls of adjacent rows perpendicular to the direction of the load. Next important one is your edge distance. Edge distance is the distance of the ball hole from the adjacent edge of the plate. So you can clarify in this figure. See here, this is a normal double bolted lap joint. You see, what is your pitch distance? Distance between two balls parallel to the direction of force. Direction of force is this. These are your direction of force. This are your direction of force. So these are the two balls, right? So the distance between these two balls, the distance parallel to this force, the distance between two balls is what? Your pitch distance. Now what is the gauge distance? Distance between two consecutive balls, the distance, perpendicular distance between two consecutive balls to the force is your gauge distance. Okay, edge distance is what? Nothing but the distance of the bolt hole, this bolt hole, from the adjacent edge of the plate. Okay, understood? Now next, if we see, is the let's see now some of the common specifications which you will be requiring in your solving problems on bolted connections. Some of the common one, okay, these are what? See, pitch distance, how much should be a minimum, maximum, all those things on pitch distance. Pitch distance, the minimum pitch distance should be how much? 2.5 into the nominal diameter of the bolt. And this you will get in your IS code 800 in 2007, clause number 10.2.2. Next is what? The maximum for tension members. That means the maximum pitch distance for the tension member is how much? It is 16T or 200 mm. Smaller of these two will be the maximum for tension members. Okay, this also you will get in your clause number 10.2.3.2 IS 800 2007. This was, see here, for pitch distance, the maximum pitch distance was how much? Smaller of these two for tension members. Now there is maximum for compression member, it is different. That means 12T, the thickness of the thinner plate, 12T, T is nothing but the thickness of the thinner plate. Okay, so 12T or 200 mm, smaller of these two will be your maximum pitch distance for compression members. Okay, this you will get in your clause number 10.2.3.2 IS 800 2007. Now is your edge distance. Now let us see what is the minimum edge distance. The minimum should be 1.5 times the diameter of the hole. And what this you will get in your clause number 10.2.4.2 of IS 800 2007. Again, now maximum is how much? 12 into thickness of the thinner plate into the epsilon. And epsilon, you know these things. What is epsilon? Epsilon is nothing but root over 250 by Fy. You know this thing. This, if you don't know, you can see in your IS code this thing. this you will get the maximum edge distance in cross number 10.2.4.3 of IS 800. Okay, now next is the clearance for fastener of holes. Okay, how much should be the clearance of the fasteners? Ball diameter is different, but the hole diameter must be different, right? Then only your fastener or the bolt will have a grip and it will enter to connect the two plates. So this is the table where you can see here, when your diameter of the bolt in mm is between 12 to 14, then your clearance is how much? 1. That means if suppose your ball diameter is 13 mm, suppose 12 mm, then what happened? 12 plus 1 mm, you have to give a clearance for the ball to enter. That means this is the 12 plus 1 will be 13. That means the diameter of the hole is how much? D naught is D plus 1. That means D plus 1. Now if your bolt diameter is 16 to 22, suppose it is 20 mm, so this D is 20 mm, that clearance must be how much? 2. Clearance of 2 mm should be added. That means 20 plus 2, that means D plus 2, 22 it will be. For 24, when the diameter of the bolt is 24, your clearance to be added with 24 number of bolt is 2 to get the diameter of the hole. Then comes, if it is greater than 24, your clearance should be added 3 plus 3 you have to do. If your diameter of the bolt is greater than 24, that means, see here, diameter of the bolt will be D plus 3. That means 24 plus greater than 24, right? So suppose 26 plus 3. Okay, so this you will also get in your table 19, page number 73 of IS 800. So thank you so much for watching, and if you like this video, please like and subscribe. Thank you.